Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord as we celebrate and worship together. Believe it or not, our vacation Bible school starts this week, and this is our t-shirt that we'll be wearing, Hero Hotline. If you haven't already signed up to be part of it or to support it, you can make a donation that helps with the supplies, or you can come and join us this week and help out with crafts or snacks. So we have a wonderful opportunity. Believe it or not, we had about 140 or 150 children ready to go, and then we've added some. So we've added a whole group from First Baptist, believe it or not. They weren't having one, so one of our people said, can I invite those kids? I said, bring them all. So we're going to have a great group here, about 150, 160 kids. Be wonderful. We also have opportunity for Bible study, and you'll note in the bulletin for our next Bible study with the pastor, me, is John, and that starts August 16th for the Zoom class or the daytime, 10 a.m. in the parlor on Thursdays, August 17th. We also have a church council on August 20th, and you want to mark your calendar for wonderful celebration, our 120th anniversary. That's in November, but we also have a special dinner in October, especially if you have family that have been connected here for a while, or you want to make sure folks who've moved away want to know what's going on, give us a shout out, and we'll make sure they get included in these events. Let's prepare our hearts for worship as we stand and join in our opening hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus. Affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose and he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then she shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. before you're seated, if you'll turn around and look at one another and give a heads up upstairs too and all around in the chapel a little bit. Great to see everybody. Our scripture this morning comes first to us from Proverbs 16, verse 1. To humans belongs the plan of the heart, but from the Lord comes the proper answer of the tongue. From Philippians 4, 5. Let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. And then finally from Hebrews 13, 1 and 2. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your presence. My words become your message for each of us, your people, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we move further along in our sermon series on the fruit of the Spirit, we come to perhaps the most misunderstood an even undervalued gift of all, gentleness. Now, some might confuse gentleness and meekness with weakness, but it is far from it. Only a strong and spiritually mature person knows how to avoid insensitivity and rude, abrupt tones. You see, gentle people have no need to dominate or manipulate because they possess some of the highest gifts of the Spirit. Those gifts are the submission to God and the consideration for others. It's also known as the first commands: love God and love your neighbor. Now, Jesus is, in fact, the epitome of gentleness. When the Messiah is talked about in the prophets, especially in Isaiah chapter 40 and 42, he describes the Messiah, the Savior of the world, coming as the shepherd who gently leads the flock. He is considered so cautious and kind that he will not crush or break a tender reed. The King of Glory, the Lord of the universe, is described by Zechariah, the prophet, for the Palm Sunday procession as humble and riding on a donkey as he enters his kingdom riding on the donkey. Now, what does Proverbs 16:1 tell us? There are ways that we have plans made in our hearts, but God gives us the right words. Right words, speaking in a gentle tone. The Lord is sovereign. God has created us all. God has a purpose for everything under the sun. God detests arrogance and spiritual pride. God is pleased with the one who turns to him in humble obedience, away from violence, away from arrogant self-centeredness. It's interesting that Paul is the one writing about the fruit of the Spirit. You see, Paul, who was Saul at one time, remembers being that arrogant, self-righteous terrorist going after Christians. He had to be transformed by God's Spirit. The man called Saul breathed threats against God's people. He was present at the stoning of Stephen, the first martyr of the church. He was anything but gentle. He believed his self-righteous acts were honoring God. But Saul had literally been a bully. He was ready to crush anyone who believed differently than he did. He was, in his own eyes, a righteous man, no doubt, but with very little patience and kindness and consideration and gentleness. These are the fruit of the Spirit he has received in Christ. Now, Paul would agree that if you think gently and act gently, you will resemble Jesus Christ. Jesus himself described his own gentle approach in Matthew 11. He says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle. I am humble. You will find rest for your weary souls." Pastor Rick Warren of Saddleback Church says that learning to be gentle is so important for a follower of Jesus Christ because gentleness diffuses conflict. It disarms the critic. It is persuasive and attractive. It communicates love. Most importantly, gentleness makes you more like Jesus. In James 3:3, it asks, "Who among us is wise and understanding? Let them be the one to show it by their good life, by their deeds done in humility, by their gentleness that comes from wisdom." You see, gentle is not hurried or harried. Gentleness is a gift of God's Spirit. It helps the believer to be understanding, forgiving, wise, and not quarrelsome. Gentle is the opposite of harsh, demanding, arrogant, confrontational. It entails both the submission to God and the consideration of others. Now, you and I look to Jesus Christ as the example and the model of gentleness, and we know that he is angry at times. So gentle doesn't mean without anger, but anger is used for justice and righteousness, not for petty disagreement. You see, when we are disciples, we live out this command to love God and to love our neighbor. It shows respect with calm assurance, and it builds trust. Gentle isn't passive, just as Jesus is not passive. Rather, it is poised with a measurable strength and conviction which knows the human condition, knows the power of words, and chooses to use words and deeds to bring life, not harm. You see, the gentle person can be trusted. They are trustworthy and dependable. They regularly practice compassion and tact. Gentleness exemplified in Jesus Christ and imparted through Christ has no need for drama or unhealthy and toxic games of blaming and shaming and manipulating. St. Paul had a long way to go from being Saul to Paul. In 1 Corinthians 13, he describes love, but it also describes gentleness. It is not irritable or resentful. It doesn't keep a record of wrongs. It is patient. It is not envious or boastful. When we say someone is loving, we usually imply that they have a gentle spirit, that they are kind, considerate, and understanding. Only God can make us gentle. It is not our human bent to be gentle, to be sincere, to be impartial, to be a peacemaker. This is not born in us every day, but it can be manifested through God's Holy Spirit. Sometimes it's cultivated and manifested in tribulation, even in grief. The author of Peter Pan, James Barry, was asked by someone, "Where did your mother get her lovely, gentle, and sympathetic eyes?" And he answered, "She got them when my younger brother died in infancy." Her gentleness was born out of vulnerability. When Paul hears complaints about some of the Corinthians being puffed up and arrogant, he says, "Shall I come to you with a rod of discipline, or shall I come in love with a gentle spirit?" The kingdom of God is not arrogant. It is not to be talked about in that manner. It is dependent upon God's power and our great love. In 1 Thessalonians 2:7, Paul writes, "We proved to be gentle among you." As a nursing mother tenderly cares for her own children, he's describing his ministry like a nursing mother tenderly caring for you. You see, gentleness contrasts with enmity, dissension, division, unbridled anger. The Greek word for gentle also means meek, praios, meekness. Again, we don't understand meekness. In Matthew 5:5, Jesus declares, "Blessed are the meek, the gentle ones, for they shall inherit the earth." What does he mean? That God has a preference to entrust the stewardship of his earth, his entire planet, to humble, kind, and gentle people. Those are the ones he wants to inherit the beauty of creation. The gentle care for others. In this polarizing and divisive time we live in, it's tempting to feel the need to shout over the crowd, to quarrel, to offer shame towards one another or blame, to argue our side without rest. Jesus did the opposite. Proverbs goes as far as saying that those who cannot use the kind word, they will fall to folly. Proverbs 15, "A gentle answer turns away wrath, but the harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise commends knowledge, but the mouth of the fool gushes with folly." The Holy Spirit, God's third person, is called the Holy Comforter. I remember when I was a young child, I literally thought it was a comforter, like a blanket on your bed. I remember hearing those words that the Holy Spirit, the third person of Christ and Jesus and God, is a holy comforter, a big blanket. Think about your comforter on your bed. or maybe a throw on the side that you pull over yourself for warmth. The Holy Comforter, the Advocate, Jesus said he is the one who will come alongside of us to help us. Paul asserts in 2 Corinthians 1:3, God is the God of all comfort. It does not mean there are times when we need discomfort or when we have to deal with difficult things, but that God's Spirit is offered as comfort and assurance. There's a strength and a power and gentleness. It's an extraordinary force of symbolic resistance. We can look through history, not only in Jesus the Christ, but in persons like Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., who looked to Jesus for this nonviolent resistance. Gentleness is life-giving, a transformational power. It is a superpower. Self-control, even when one has power. It is a control over the temperament, even the emotions, not surrendering to chaos. You see, meekness and gentleness are the means by which God trains the soul to tame the temper, to subdue aggression, to calm anxiety, to bring order out of chaos in our lives. Untamed, we appear very restless, short-tempered, impatient, enamored with our own opinions. Gentleness is a sign of God's presence and power in our lives, that we have submitted to God and we are considerate of our neighbor. It is a gift to be gentle. You see, God has created us in such a way that he can temper us, giving us gentleness to temper the expectations we have of others so that they are not unrealistic or hostile. That we are aware of the human condition. Not that we say anything goes, but that we understand everyone is on a path and not everyone has grown up. The gentle ones find joy in the evidence of God's grace all around us. The gentle one has forgiveness in their heart because they are grateful that they are forgiven. The gentle take time before they form a judgment or an opinion. The gentle know that constant complaining is contagious, so they would rather not linger around people who are full of complaint. The gentle celebrate with others. The gentle have a discerning spirit to pay close attention to the messages of God given every single day. The gift of the Holy Spirit for gentleness enables us to walk with Christ in resemblance, walking with grace, goodness, love. In Philippians, Paul asked us to let our gentleness be evident to others. He had to go through that transformation himself. When the first Christians are encountering Paul after his transition, after his change, they are frightened. His reputation preceded him. They knew he harassed Christians, he jailed them, he bludgeoned them, and they were quite anxious when Paul came to be among them. Paul tells us, "Let your gentleness be evident." He's had to make it evident to prove that God has changed him, calling him to lead in the church. In Hebrews 13, we are reminded that gentleness shows love. It shows hospitality. It even entertains angels, the gifts of God. When we look at Jesus, we realize that gentleness does not eliminate anger. I mentioned earlier, anger is used for big things, injustice, for things happening in the world that are horrible and cruel. That is where anger belongs, not in our day in, day out experience. If we are called and equipped to be gentle, it will be God working in us, not something we were born with or something we muster up because we're such good people. It is the work of the Holy Spirit. This is how the fruit is born in us. God grows it. We simply open our lives and our hearts to show it. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our song of reflection is I Surrender All. At this time, if you will take out your Holy Communion and prepare. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart,
We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, if you'll take your bread. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you and he broke it, giving it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Jesus Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, as we come before you, we come in awe and wonder the gentleness of Christ. For in his great compassion and his love, he offered us forgiveness. Even when he was on the cross, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Help us, O God, to receive that forgiveness, to receive it as a healing balm, a word of hope that transforms us, that enables us to be open to receive the gifts of your Holy Spirit, that fruit may be evident in our lives. Help us, O God, to receive this Holy Communion, to receive your gift of life and love and hope. May we offer all of our prayers in the name of Jesus as we sing together the prayer he taught us. Let us stand now for our closing hymn, Softly and Tenderly Jesus is Calling.
Thank you.
As we receive the benediction, I remind you the pedestals are a wonderful way to offer your support or to scan the code. We also invite you to have a time of refreshment in the parlor, and we have wonderful treats for you and hot and cold drinks, so we hope you'll join with us. Let us receive God's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you. Make his gentleness known as a response that you would receive his forgiveness and in turn extend it to others to be a light in this often dark world. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, amen.